for an excellent scientific feast before we go in for the feast of the lunch, which is personally taken care of by Dr. Vijay Kumar. Dr. Krishna Shishari needs no introduction. He is synonymous with science and is a part of all the scientific program committee of all the successful conferences. He is a senior consultant endocrinologist in Apollo Hospitals and Fortis Munnar Hospitals, and he will be presenting on perfect partners for better control. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Okay. Hello. Thank you so much. I know I'm standing between you and lunch. What I will do is to talk about combinations. I don't believe about my wife and I are the first people to accept that we are not perfect partners. We live together and have certain harmony. So similarly, you know, you can have harmony, but I don't think anyone can be perfect. Perfect is a state of the mind. These are my conflicts of interest. So let's quickly run. In intensive glycemic control reduce events in the UKPDS follow-up trial, as opposed to the ACCORD trial, because A, UKPDS trial was better designed. B, it recruited patients with new onset diabetes. ACCORD trial reduced glucoses more rapidly, or more insulin was used in the ACCORD trial. How many people think A is the answer? B, should I get some coffee? C, no C's also. D, you will learn thongrange. Sure. Okay. Important thing to remember is, if I were to redesign the UKPDS trial, I would do a lot of things differently, but since I'm not the person there, remember that it was not a really well-designed trial. There were huge issues with it. On the other hand, if you look at all these trials, and you will notice that the only trial that showed benefit was the UKPDS trial. That is simply because that it recruited patients just at the onset of diabetes. These are newly diagnosed diabetic patients. Why? We can go into a whole discussion on this, but importantly remember that at some point of time, irrespective of what you do, the cells start having, the damage becomes irreversible. They go on to a cycle that keeps working on this. So clearly, one of the reasons, and the most important reasons, is early detection and early treatment. So this is a question that we've been talking about. It's called bad glycemic legacy, that there is a point of no return beyond which, whatever you do, patients don't benefit, right? So one of the interesting things that we wanted to do was that you want to go early, hit them hard, reach those targets quite early, and which also means that after some time, even if you relax a little bit, it doesn't hurt you. So the correct answer is, the UKPD has recruited patients with new onset diabetes. Let me see if people answer the next one. The ADA guidelines recommend initial combination therapy, one, in all patients, B, patients with symptoms, C, patients with A1C greater than 9, D, patients with A1C greater than 7.5, and E, patients with A1C greater than 1.5 above target. How many people think A is the answer? Wake up, one person. B, no B. C, some C's. D, E, no E's. Oh my God. So remember that this is the window of opportunity. So what really happens is this, that it takes a long time for us to escalate therapy. On the other hand, what you want is here. You wanted to bring it down and keep it down. So after many years, the ADA started talking about individualizing therapy, something which we were doing for many, many years. They stood up and look at this. But respective of what we do in our care, it takes a long time to start more drugs. This is Kamlesh Kunti's data, right? If the A1C was greater than 8 and the patient was 1 OAD, it took another 1.5 years to add another drug. It took 7 years to add insulin. If the person was 3.3, is on 3 OADs, to just add another drug, it took 6 years, similar amount to take insulin. So it's not just that our patients are, of course, they will find every excuse to manipulate us and get out of this new drug. But we are also very reluctant to add drugs simply because most important reason is we don't want to lose our patients, right? So there's a huge glycemic burden. Now the fallacy in this particular slide is this, that it counts anybody who reached that A1C. But you will notice that when people will attain a goal, but they will not maintain and not keep the goal. This is simply because, again, we don't have the time. It's a chronic disease. Our therapies are at best fluid, and patients don't perceive benefit. Each of these are important, but this is all we have, and this is all we have to work with. So the correct answer is, after many years, the ADA at least finally looked up. Last time they said A1C of greater than 9. This year's regular, this thing they finally said, if it's more than 1.5 above target, start using combinations. Why? Because of several reasons. Let's talk about that. The first thing is to remember, what is a normal A1C? A lot of times we think about 6.5, right? But remember that 6.5 is not the normal A1C. In this population, the normal A1C is around 5.5. So somebody who's just diagnosed with diabetes, you reduce some of his risk when you bring it to 6.5, but you don't bring it to zero. A 40-year-old man with new onset diabetes really requires greater effort to keep him almost hyperglycemia free, right? That is our objective. But see where the difference between what is normal and what is abnormal is. It's one. The second thing is, we talk so much about lifestyle. It's important. But there is a time when we should say, okay, go ahead and do the lifestyle. I know you're still going to go to the weddings, you're still going to have the jangri, you're not. So it's all right, start the medication. This time lag between saying lifestyle, in fact, every conference I go, the moment I talk about medications, what about lifestyle? You didn't talk about it. Sir, yes, I have talked about lifestyle. It's important. Do it. But remember, this is all it achieves. This is a look-ahead trial. So make sure you have medications on board early. So the correct answer is, that's very important. Let me ask you a third question. The moment you start drugs, we're always worried that is it going to be toxic? Is it going to bring it too low? Or we have great expectations. When we combine two drugs, we think that the A1C should become normal. So let me ask you a question. What is the average A1C reduction achieved with combination of two drugs? One, let us say one does one, another does one. Is 1+1, 2? First question. Second, is 1+1, 3? Third, of course, it depends. And lastly, is 1+1 usually 1.5? How many people think it's 1+1 is 2? No one. How many people think 1+1 is 2.5? Many people. Too much expectations. All of us want perfect partners. It never happens. How many people think it's 1+1 is equal to 1.5? Right. So when you do a meta-analysis of studies using initial combination, you'll find that newer studies show greater improvement and a greater A1C of 7. You also find that with the newer ones, hyperglycemia is actually lower. So in the previous thing, the problem with combinations was hyperglycemia was a big issue. Now that's not there. Also, this question is, does it improve durability? And the answer seems to be yes, because, and these are very limited studies, that when you combine two drugs of different pathophysiology, it seems to be that you have greater benefit and longer durability. Having said that, I believe that any combination works. For example, a lot of people kill sulfonylureas because of the ADOPT trial. In the ADOPT trial, the durability was 3 years, which is very good for a drug. So don't put it down. This is data from CANAMET plus metformin. Again, you will see that there is an equation that can predict what is the A1C lowering with two drugs. For those of you who are interested, I'm happy to give it to you. It is a useless equation. It gives a lot of mathematics, but it will tell you exactly how much lowering will occur. So this is looking at observed, what do you want, what is predicted, and you will find that the predicted, that when two drugs are combined, it's never the sum of the two. So it's usually this less than the sum of the A1C reduction of each agent. And of course, I don't want to go into this. Remember that you want to try to treat different pathophysiologies. The data, again, for this is very, very small. But many people find that when you combine two or three drugs, the chances of getting an A1C that is quite low without hyperglycemia is very high. For example, Dr. DeFranzo talks about using metformin, pioglitazone, a GLP-1-RA, and now he's talking about a 4-drug, an SGLT2 inhibitor. But then neither are we Dr. DeFranzo's patients, nor am I Dr. DeFranzo. Right? That brings us to the combination of DPP-4 and SGLT2. Looks like to be a great combination, right? So the important thing is both are different in action. Now, the most important thing is when you give them together in a single drug, will the bioequivalence be the same? The answer is yes, that we don't have to worry. The one issue was everybody thought when you combined the SGLT2 with the DPP-4 inhibitor, what would happen is the SGLT2 inhibits a glucagon, increases glucagon, the DPP-4 decreases glucagon. They thought that the glucagon levels will come down and therefore you'll have a complementary or an additive effect. That we did not see simply because, I won't spend time on this, the DPP-4, I talked about it, that DPP-4s are not very strong GLP inhibiting, GLP agents. Therefore, the glucagon reduction with DPP-4s is not very high. It's not as high as a GLP-1. A GLP-1 plus an SGLT2 inhibitors, the glucagon levels are boom, down. That doesn't happen with the DPP-4 combination. Therefore, it's a good combination. So is there anything magic about it? Probably not, but a good combination. So what happens when you combine both of these, and this is looking on a metformin background at different things, you will find that 1 plus 1 is 1.6 or 1.8. You will find that the A1C reduction is 1.2 with the combination, and it's an improvement on both of these. It's durable. The odds of raising an A1C is higher, right? And each of the benefits of both SGLT2 and DPP-4s are maintained. Weight neutrality with DPP-4, weight reduction with SGLT2. So that is present, right? And the blood pressure reduction and the weight reduction of the SGLT2 are also maintained. And they're fairly safe. Hyperglycemia is lower. Again, this Asian paradox is seen with the combination of empalina versus this thing. And interestingly, and this is Dr. Venkatraman's favorite point also, is that when you give a DPP-4 with an SGLT2, the only added benefit besides all of these is that the number of genitourinary infections come down. Now, I have traced this original article to a Japanese paper in an obscure Japanese microbiology paper, which says the fungi have DPP-4 receptors. Everybody has used this thing. I haven't seen any corroborative evidence, but we will quote this exotic Japanese paper. But it looks like when you combine these two drugs, it gets better. To summarize, let's go back. I think we are in need of combination drugs. Why? We need adherence to improve. One of the reasons to use combination drugs, especially if they are proven, is doctors can start using them quite early, and we don't have to give two drugs. What I like about combination of these two drugs is the cost comes down. From 100 bucks to it comes down to 70 bucks. So that way I'm happy. Or even 70 bucks is too much, but it's there. The added advantage is you combine a DPP-4 with SGLT2 inhibitor, the risk of genitourinary infection comes down. Are they perfect partners? Go look at your partner and you'll know the answer. Is it workable? Absolutely. I've been living with mine for 20 years. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for an excellent presentation.
Question, sir. Sir, you were talking about sulfonate urease, sir. When using sulfonate urease, aren't you whipping a tired horse, sir?
Sir, it depends on which stage of the disease is it, sir. I think in someone who does not have we should not be unfair to the sulfonylureas. In patients who are young, in patients who do not have established cardiovascular disease, in patients who do not have long-standing diabetes, correct? There is no data to support that sulfonylureas are inferior. They are good drugs. Where would I be careful about sulfonylureas? Someone, an older sulfonylurea and someone with established myocardial infarction, I would not use it. In patients who have recurrent risks of hyperglycemia, correct? In the very elderly, these are the three places where I will use caution with sulfonylureas. Sir, this is a condition where the duration of treatment is very important. As I frequently tell my patients and I used to teach also, so is that somebody shouldn't have to sell their Mangal Sutra to buy medications. We need to be very careful to use. So these three areas, I will be very careful. Everywhere else, I use a lot of sulfonylureas and I'm very happy with them.
Sir, I have a small suggestion. Whether we can use Many studies have shown EMPA half tablet, I mean 25 half, and 10 lig Lipton, will it be less expensive?
Absolutely. I think when we have the science, when you are convinced about the efficacy of the molecules, then we want to pass on the benefits to our patients. At the same time, we balance the cost which will be accrued out of the patients. So never in the literature it's mentioned that you can break EMPA 25 into half and give. But having realized that EMPA 10 and 25 are the same cost, when you want to give, you do it. In fact, I think this suggestion was given by Anand Moses. Initially, I was slightly reluctant. I started doing it. Of course, these are all off-label. I mean, across small groups like this, we can discuss, because the cost benefit is huge. And you are passing on the benefits of these molecules. And with respect to the data, I think I was part of another study wherein we compared the efficacy of glimepiride with metformin fixed dose combination to sitagliptin metformin fixed dose combination. The efficacy, the safety are almost comparable, provided you use judiciously. This was in about 200 or 300 patients. It was an open label trial. It is not a randomized trial. So as Krishna nicely alluded to, I think certainly neurosulfonylureas is used judiciously. Certainly, they are going to the drugs of choice in the practice, provided you are aware of the situations wherein you need to titrate the dose and avoid. And the elderly diabetics, I think DPP-4 inhibitors, certainly, certainly. And you need not worry about the duration of diabetes. I think TCOS and other studies have established that even with the duration of more than 10, 12 years of diabetes, these molecules are effective.
Starting of metformin and irreversible damage at the end of the day.
So there's no mechanistic study that has looked at it. But tomorrow, if you stay for my talk on diabetes in this information, I will talk about the substrate in which drugs are given. For example, the benefit, even with absolute risk reduction that Dr. Venkatraman alluded to, the ARR is not the same for for different population risks. So the lower the risk and the longer the duration. For example, you started somebody in metformin and the patient is new onset diabetes, right? At the benefit starts at 45, it goes on till 75. On the other hand, let's say somebody has 10 years of diabetes, has an A1C of 8.5, and is going to be started on insulin. The question is, at 75, should you even start insulin for an 8.5, because you're not going to have benefit, you're going to have risk. So I think this is a little degree of understanding, but I think what we need to understand is that drugs benefits, we need to stop believing that direct, when we see an RR chart, 23% in risk of reduction in risk of hypoglycemia when compared to comparator, that translates into less than 1% benefit. That 1% benefit in the normal population, what about a high risk population? So we need to be very careful about using data. Generally, I think our common sense, evidence is important, but our common sense is even more important.
Would the combination help us in preventing the glucotoxicity, hence we are able to come down?
Absolutely, absolutely. So my suggestion is, in this regard, disregard all the guidelines. Somebody who's got an A1C more than 7 requires one drug. Greater than 8 requires 2 drugs. Greater than 9 requires 3 or insulin. The earlier you do it, the better. Don't give time.
We'll do it later because we are running out of time. And it's a very good, excellent session. Please give them a big hand. And don't miss that 30 years lecture also.